Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Science Thursday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at moon mining. So let's dive right into it. So the idea of moon mining is very lucrative. It's very near and dear to us because we think this will be the first time human would be mining in space. So suffice to say, it has quite a attractive ring to it. And as in many of you know who are in touch with space news, everybody is kind of waiting for the next gold rush. And suffice to say, enough people think that mining asteroid or mining moon will be the next big thing. Basically, you will make lot of money doing this. Same way Silicon Valley and industrial technology has reached its peak point, so the next thing would be this. And under no circumstances I can undersell you the value of this. This will act as a stepping stone for humanity. Humanity will remain trapped in Earth unless we can properly conquer the moon, as in full 100%. Like, moon should not even be a thing that some people go to. It would be like oh, you want to go to moon? Okay, in the summer vacation we're gonna go to the moon. It's family sort of destination. I don't think people are gonna live there because it's suicide, but we will have a lot of industrial reason to do so. So let's dive right into it. So why we have so much interest in this or not Mars? One simple reason: money. Like, right now, no matter what you do, as many of you know who have followed Elon Musk, he also specified that if they found raw cocaine, which is more expensive than gold, it's still not worth to bring it back, because the energy spent going to the Mars and then coming from there, nothing is worth that kind of money. To give you a context, let's say even if you found platinum, if you try to sold that platinum here, nobody is gonna buy it. Not because, like, it may sell as a niche item, but it will not sell as platinum because it will cost way too much. So moon is very interesting because we reached to the moon in 1960s and 70s. It is actually doable. So the aspect of money, the aspect that it is in space, and the fact that it is doable creates all this interesting phenomena. Like, we have already done that. Like, this is not far-fetched. We haven't sent anything big to Mars. Like, the biggest thing I can think of is a Curiosity rover, which is only 1 ton. So suffice to say, we are kind of far away from landing on Mars. So moon becomes a very interesting point for us. This is why we have so much interest in it. There is money in it, there is space in it, and it is doable. So what kind of hope is sold to public here? Now, I recently just watched that Kirkusar, I will link the video down below, and many other cool videos. There are many, many people saying, like, moon has trillions and trillions of dollars of worth. So how that worth is coming from is that, A, mining the moon will make us a lot of money. True. Now, because there is helium-3, everybody is like, we can mine helium-3. Now, those of you who are not familiar with nuclear fusion, you have to understand this one thing. If you do normal fusion, as in hydrogen fusion, it gives out what we call neutron. Neutron is radiation. You don't want to release neutron. So if you find helium, you still get neutron. However, there is a very specific isotope of helium, which we call helium-3, that if you do fusion with that, it gives out basically proton. Now you might be like, okay, still giving out something, then what's the interesting part? Because proton is electronically charged, as in it has inherent electric potential, it is very easy to extract that electrical potential out of it. Very easy. Basically, neutron will not react to a magnetic field, so we have to let neutron be absorbed by a heating element, whatever that is, like a absorption material, and then it boils the water. That way we run the steam, and then we run the generator, and then we get the electricity. Here, because that motion, that the moment you fuse it, the motion that is there in the proton is going through a coil, but proton has its own magnetic field. So magnetic field interacting with another magnetic field, we can extract the energy out of it. So it's direct conversion. Now, of course, it's not like if you have helium-3 fusion, there is no neutron. Of course, it's just it's called aneutroning because almost 90% of the energy that is being released is released in the format of protons, not neutrons. So it's safe. Now, relatively safe. Do not think like if you have a helium-3 reactor running next to you, it's not gonna release any neutron. It would be manageable, hopefully, but it's still something to be taken seriously. So if we figured out how to mine helium-3 and we started making reactor, A, reactor would be safe, B, reactor will be very small. See, because we are converting directly, the overall efficiency per kilogram of fuel would be idiotically high. It would be large enough that it can actually, let's say right now our nuclear power plant is giving out heat that is equivalent of, let's say, 10,000 megawatt. We are barely able to extract 500 to, let's say, 2,000 megawatt out of it. So yes, it is that wasteful. Like, we barely struggling to barely reach 50% efficiency. So helium-3 bypasses all that. It's like directly 80 to 90% efficiency. So awesome. And then we have the fact of precious metal. Because of the crater phenomenon on the moon, basically it's getting bombarded by a lot of craters, there is a very serious probability that a lot of gold, platinum, osmium, and what we call platinum group materials can be mined there. And as many of you know, those things are expensive. So this is also the money aspect of it. And then we have the moon colony. People want to live on the moon. Moon colony is a very lucrative idea. So this is what our hope is, that we're gonna mine materials, we're gonna mine helium-3, and then we're gonna live there. So these are our hope. So let's come to reality. First thing, this I find it very odd that almost everybody ignores the fact that we don't have fusion yet. Like, we are nowhere near a place where we can say, okay, we're gonna have fusion next 10 years or next 30 years. And many of you say, we're gonna have this 30 years. Yeah, we've been hearing that for 3 times. I have already made a video about dream of fusion power, which you can check out here. And point of that video was very simple. Like, if it ever comes out to be true, it's awesome. But so far, because the complexity involved, like, this machine is not easy. Like, even if this machine works, it's gonna cost billions of dollars. And I'm not talking the engineering aspect of it. I'm not talking about the PhD people you have to pay. I'm just talking about this machine itself. This is cryogenics and super hot plasma in the same place. So we are nowhere near to say that, okay, fusion is gonna be the next big thing. We are nowhere near to say that. Like, we need to see at least 1 to 10 reactors working continuously, 24/7. Because let's say this starts to do what we call break even. Basically, you put 10 megawatt in, it starts to give out 500 megawatt out. Awesome. But can it continuously do that for 10 years, 20 years? Because power plants are not something that you can have, it's going down. So we are nowhere near that. Second, we die without gravity. So in Kakasad video, they specified that there will be moon colony, and they're gonna make a moon baby out of there. It's not happening. Human body needs gravity. Now in space, we can easily do that because we can spin things up. As many of you have seen the movie Elysium, that is a very tangible, approachable, and actually doable thing, because in that way you can live in space. Maintaining temperature, air pressure is super easy. Creating gravity is very hard. We have no idea how gravity travels in the first place. So if we can create spin gravity, which is almost same, and especially if you have a very large diameter, you will not have to worry about Coriolis effect and other sort of effects. They will still play a role, but they won't be very noticeable. So basically your head won't be like low gravity, your leg would be high gravity. So all things considered, you can't live on the moon. Like, of course, you can go there to work there. But if you did that for long enough, like a movie Moon, it was a very good independent movie, Moon showed that, you're gonna suffer very serious health consequences. And I'm not talking about radiation. Let's say you bury it down enough that no radiation is reaching there. You can maintain the air pressure, you can maintain everything. You still don't have gravity. You will suffer very serious consequences because of that. Then helium-3 is not abundant on moon. It's not like you go to moon and you're just like, okay, I'm gonna collect helium-3. Yeah, this is your helium-3. It's not gonna be collecting like this, collecting around. Oh, this is helium-3. Helium-3 is a gas. On top of that, it's a very rare gas. So to give you a context, that movie that I'm referring to, Moon, actually tried to show a very tangible way to do that. You have to extract hundreds and hundreds of hectares of land and then process the regolith, then you might get a little bit of helium-3. So all this design that they show, they're gonna collect the regolith being soil on the moon, and they're gonna heat it up to 800 degrees Celsius, and then helium-3 is gonna pour out. Everything is fine. It's just they forgot to mention that you have to do that to hundreds of tons, then you may get 1 or 2 gram of helium-3. To give you a context to when somebody says trillion ton, it sounds big, but to give you a context, you have more gold, as in raw gold, in seawater than you have helium-3 on moon. So is it extractable? Yes. because the benefit is very shallow, like we don't have to go very deep. However, two consequences come up there. First, if you start mining that, you will change the face of moon. I'm talking like entire swaths of moon would be changed. Now, of course, moon is not a luxury item. We can do things of that nature. But to give you a context, you will see different moon out there. Like the mass of moon won't be affected. Nothing will change. But moon will, to give you a context, like you will see it from Earth that, oh, this 50,000 kilometer area was like, mined for hydrogen, helium-3. And on top of these sort of thing, to give you a breakdown of what kind of mineral, as in what level of elements we have on moon, because of Apollo project, we have a kind of very good grasp for students, is that if you want oxygen, moon got a lot of it. Like if you take moon's crust, it has 42% oxygen. So stuff, and it's very easily extractable. You can just bake it out of a regolith, provided you have energy to heat the material up. And then we have silicon. Not that useful, but okay, good to have. Then we have iron, very useful. If we can mix iron with carbon, we get steel. Then we have calcium, useful in some regard. Then we have aluminum, very interesting space material. And then we have magnesium and 3% other. Now, can anybody tell what are the two elements missing in this, which is crucial for life? Yes, you guessed it right. Hydrogen and basically carbon is missing. Basically, we are lacking hydrocarbon in moon. So even if you see, like, because of Chandrayaan mission, we now know what level of water is present in lunar poles. It's not enough. Like, it's, yeah, it's million tons. We consume that, like a small town consumes that kind of water. And if you want to do industrial process with that and make rocket fuel out of it, it's no longer as big as you think. Now, of course, it's sufficient for, let's say, 10 to 20 years. But what are you gonna do after that? So understand that oxygen is not on a short supply. We have more than sufficient oxygen on moon, but we do not have hydrogen, nor we have carbon. We need a lot of hydrogen to actually sustain human life on moon. And this aspect is only focused by some people, that this gold rush cannot be sustained, because once you start mining moon for gold, other companies will also try to do that. Now, once you start importing either from moon or from other asteroid, the price collapse will happen. Now, it won't happen one day. Like, let's say 100 tons of moon refined gold came down to Earth and now it's price collapse will happen. No, but over time, as in 10 years. Now, people who are very skeptical of it, they say the price collapse will happen in 10 years. People who are like, old and they have seen enough market crashes, they are like, yeah, 50 years. Worst case scenario, like, the longest estimate is 100 years. But it will happen. Basically, you may be alive to see price collapse happen, because once enough gold starts to come in, gold no longer is precious. Precious things have to be scarce. So what we're gonna do with that gold? Yeah, we're gonna put that in your mobile phone. Like many of you know, we try to use as much gold as we want, but because of expense, we don't do it. We try to mix gold with copper. So of course, your electronics will start having proper pure gold, but it will lose the value. Platinum will also have the same issue. So yes, at the beginning, there will be a lot of money to be made, but after a while, it won't be. And we might be back to the same situation as Cold War. Basically, we went to the moon because of this, and then we left the moon. So I don't want people to leave moon again. So this is crucial. Understand this. Precious metal is not gonna print money for humanity, because not to mention, it's not also there. It's like lying there. You can't just go, oh, okay, this rock is of platinum, I'm gonna collect it. You still have to do the same process that you do on Earth. It's just the probability of you finding useful platinum would be higher. So this is the reality. So let's talk about steps that we're gonna take for our moon mission. So first step is power. Now I'm gonna make a dedicated video on this matter in the next Future Friday episode. So first thing first, we have to get as much power as we need. Solar panels are a good way. It's a good start, but it's not gonna take us in the future, especially if you want to do very serious heavy mining. Heavy industry is not gonna run on solar panels. So I'm gonna specify how we can get more power out of it. Then we have to build habitats. Now on moon, nobody wants to actually live there, but in the early stages of colonization, we're gonna have people working there, because all the equipments, all the robots that we're gonna build, and rovers and mining equipments, is gonna break down a lot, and we need to collect enough data. We need to repair those things, so people staying there will allow us to get a handle on the situation. And the movie Moon actually showed it quite well. Like, they had old helium-3 mining facility, it was manned by one person. So that kind of scenario will happen, that one or two people will be there, you know, just as a backup, like how pilots are in an autopiloted plane. But they won't be necessary. They will be like, okay, if things go wrong, and more with better and more advanced artificial intelligence and good robotics, we may not even need that. We may even have them as back on Earth, so, and only send people if things go really out of hand. Then we have to do production. Now, habitats can be underground. That would be the best scenario. Right now, our current estimate is that we have some lava tube close enough to our region of interest that we can actually just land outside and just go inside, because right now digging and covering things up with a regolith is a bit more energy intensive. So if we have lunar lava tubes, it's more than good enough. After we figured out how we do habitation, we have to do production. Basically, we have to do what we call replication. So one habitat will make another habitat. The habitat will try to replicate all the contents of it. Basically, 3D printer, CNC machine, PCB printers, electronic, robot that pick and place robot and things of that nature. Basically, all the manufacturing that we have in the first habitat will build a second one, and they will try to make as many copies as possible, depending on our energy output. So all things considered, we're gonna have like just one thing go there and then try to replicate as much as possible. It is doable. We just don't have that science fiction label, we have one nanobot that does it all. We don't have it that good. However, we have factory that can build enough things to build another factory that can build another factory and still do manufacturing on the side. So we have that. It's just not all in one solution that we were hoping for. After this, once we have production, then we have to find a way to use this. Now, the core advantage of lunar mining is not sending things back to Earth. It is sending things back to space, as in it may be as close to Earth as in low Earth orbit. Because to give you a context, like the energy requirement to send 100 ton from sea level to low Earth orbit is very high, versus the energy required to send from lunar surface to Earth's low Earth orbit. So for this reason, sending things from moon makes sense, even for our space, even for satellites, specifically geostationary satellite. We can barely send geostationary satellite that are 100 or 200 tons, barely. Like, we haven't done anything yet. Like, the biggest satellite I can think is still under 10 tons. But imagine geostationary satellite that are that big, that are that powerful. You can have a very large bandwidth internet for everyone on a normal mobile phone, where they won't need, it will be laggy, but it will be doable, because if you have large enough solar panel, you can do the signal amplification needed. So we need power launch. We can't rely on rockets, because rocket, as many of you know, expend propellant to get their propulsion. Now, expanding propellant for propulsion is good enough, we know how it works, but it can't be done on an industrial scale. You can't send hundreds of tons of material using rocket. It's very wasteful. So we have to do what's called electronic propulsion, basically maglev propulsion. We're gonna have either a rail cannon. I don't like the idea of rail cannon, since they are inherently try to split apart. So a maglev can get the job done, and since moon is a vacuum, you don't have air resistance, and escape velocity of moon is not that high. So we can have a normal maglev and 1 or 2 kilometers of track, and you can launch things into space. And you can also use that maglev to land things without needing to, do a boost burn. So this would be very crucial if we really want to reduce the cost of space itself, not of Earth, not of precious material, but space. Basically, if you want to make habitats out of it, like I'm talking Elysium size habitat, for that reason, we need hundreds and thousands of tons of material. That can only be done if we have a way to launch it based on the power that we are collecting, not trying to expend propellant, because that's very wasteful. And once we have figured out power launch, all we need to do after that is just make this large scale. That's it. That's the last step in this moon colonization process. The day we achieve this large scale, like the day we start to make large scale, as in like once the day we break 1 gigawatt of power on moon, the day we launch actual 100 ton of material off moon using powered launch systems, that day humanity would have reached humanity 2.0, unlocked. Humanity space race will be a reality. It won't be a science fiction concept. So these are the steps that we have to take. Now, this was my video on the topic. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. And I would say share it with your friends, whoever they may be. And if you didn't like it, don't worry about it, dislike it. And I would say leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Future Friday. And subscribe if and press the bell icon if you are free. And as always, thanks for watching.